Dear, this is Achilles Drew, when any sources get simplified. Today I'll walk you through some common steeplechase questions associated with the anatomy of the thorax. It's going to be a short session, but a very lovely one. Ensure you stick with me to the end, right? Okay, now starting with my first model. If I'm to ask you, what structure is this? Can you guess? Well, this is the first rib. Okay, the first rib is a very easy to identify rib. It is the shortest rib. It is very flat, and whenever it's lying on the table, it lies just flat. Okay, so the first rib is the shortest, very small, and very easy to recognize. And it is an atypical rib, considering the fact that it has an head with just one facet. Okay. Normally, the head of the rib is meant to have demi-facets for the vertebra above and for the vertebra beneath. But for the first rib, since there is no vertebra above, so it has just one facet, okay? So that's that about the head of the rib. Then there is a tubercle right there. And then normally the top of a rib, of a typical rib, is meant to be smooth. But for the atypical rib, there are some grooves right there. And those grooves are for the subclavian vessels passing just above the first rib. So all this makes the first rib very atypical. Alright, so note that. And in steeplechase 2, the media end of the ribs can be painted, and you'll be asked to identify one structure articulating with it. Okay, understand, for all the ribs, the media end is associated with the costal cartilage. Whenever you have a rib and the media end is painted, not the head, media end, once it is painted and you're asked to identify a structure relating to the part painted, then it is the costal cartilage. All right, so let's move on and talk about a typical rib. This is a very typical rib. All right, so, and of course it has the head with two articular facets. Here is the head right here. Okay, this is the posterior part. Okay, so, and here is a pattern to draw your attention to. Are you seeing the head? On the head, there are two facets. Here is one facet right there, and another facet right there. Okay, so, and the one on top is for articulating with the vertebra just above the rib, while the one beneath, which is the larger one, is for articulating with the numerically corresponding vertebra. For example, if this is rib number 4, then this facet right here will articulate with vertebra number 4. While the one above, I'm shading green right now, that one will articulate with vertebra number 3, okay? The vertebra just before the rib, okay? So that's that about that. And then very importantly, too, I want to draw your attention to the tubercle. The tubercle is very close to the rib too, and it can be painted to in steeplechase, and be asked that this structure is related to what? Understand that it is related to the transverse process of the vertebra. Oh, I didn't mention, for the head of the rib, the facets are related to the costal facet of the vertebra, the thoracic vertebra to be specific, okay? That's for the head. But for the tubercle is related to the transverse process of the vertebra, right? Of the thoracic vertebra to be specific, okay? And then there is usually this groove just inferior to the rib. That groove is called the costal groove. And in steeplechase, you can be asked to identify two structures related to the costal groove. Just understand the intercostal neurovasculature. You talk about the intercostal vein, intercostal artery, intercostal nerve. They are related to the costal groove, all right? So that's that. Never forget, on the media end, is related to what? It's related to the costal cartilage. Okay, let's move on to our next model. If I'm to ask you, what vertebra is this? Can you guess? Yeah, this is the thoracic vertebra. It has this very prominent spinous process, okay? So let me get you a nicer picture. Here is a vertebra, the thoracic vertebra from the side, the lateral thoracic vertebra. In steeplechase, you can be asked to give two structures that makes this thoracic vertebra, two structures that defines it as a thoracic vertebra. Well, there is usually this obvious facet for the rib, okay? the coastal facets, two demi-facets actually. So there is one on top and there is one beneath, okay? So those facets are very important for the head of the rib, okay? And right here too, we have on the transverse process, there is also this coastal facet too. This coastal facet is associated with the tubercle of the rib, okay? Let me show you a better picture. Follow me, we are looking at the vertebra from the top now. Of course, right here we have the head of the rib. The head of the rib right here is articulating with the demi-facet around there, okay? And then the tubercle of the rib, is right here, okay? And the tubercle of the rib is associating with the transverse process, of the thoracic vertebra, okay? So note that. And of course, the spinous process too can be painted and you'll be able to identify it. So that's the spinous process. So right here is the body of the thoracic vertebra. Here is the body, and it is related to the intervertebral disc. And on the intervertebral disc, this center right here is related to the nucleus propulsus of the intervertebral disc. While on the edges, is related to the annulus fibrosus of the intervertebral disc. Don't forget, the structure itself is the body of the thoracic vertebra. But if it is painted and you have to identify one structure relating to it, you have to note, is it the center that they are painting? If they are painting the center, this red part, it is related to the nucleus propulsus of the intervertebral disc. But if they are painting the edges, the one I highlighted green, those ones are related to the annulus fibrosus of the intervertebral disc. Let's move on to our next model. Okay, this structure right there, what is it? Of course, this is the sternum, okay, the breastbone. And the sternum, there is this very important quadrangular part, the manubrium of the sternum. It is often painted in steeplechase, please, okay? The manubrium of the sternum. And on the manubrium, there are two important structures I want to draw your attention to. On top of it right here, we have the jugular notch, okay? The jugular notch is right there. While on the lateral edges, we have the clavicular notch, which is where the clavicular end or the sternal end of the clavicle, that's where it inserts to, okay? The clavicular notch is right there. Don't forget, on the center, jugular notch, then lateral to it, the clavicular notches. And then all these facets are just various coastal facets for articulating with the coastal cartilage of the ribs variously. And then down here is the xiphoid process. The xiphoid process is the third part of the sternum, okay? Here is the xiphoid process. And of course, everything else is the body. Everything else is the body of the sternum. Manubrium of the sternum, body of the sternum, xiphoid process of the sternum. So very fast too, I want to draw your attention to the joints. The joints right here is the manubriosternal joint, which is where the manubrium and the body of the sternum are meeting, okay? So the manubriosternal joint, otherwise called the sternal angle, okay? It is very important. It's a very important joint, and it is related to thoracic vertebra 4 and 5, okay? T4/T5, ignore my pen, please, all right? So let's move on. Well, before I move on, let me also draw your attention to this very important joint. This joint between the xiphoid process and the body of the sternum is called the xiphisternal joint, okay? But please take good note of manubriosternal joint or the sternal angle, related to T4, T5, and it is also associated with the second rib, the second coastal cartilage to be specific, all right? So let's move down to the larynx, the laryngeal cartilages, okay? There are two very important ones that we want to draw your attention to. The thyroid cartilage. Thyroid cartilage is this one on top. And then the cricoid cartilage, all right? So the thyroid cartilage is very, very important, and it has this prominence. This prominence is called the laryngeal prominence. That prominence is often pained in steeplechase, okay? The laryngeal prominence. And it is otherwise called the Adam's apple. A number of people know it as the Adam's apple. And it is just that projection right there. Okay, so and then inferior to the thyroid cartilage, what we have is the cricoid cartilage. The cricoid cartilage actually does form a complete ring. I have a better picture of all this, I'll show you in a second. So that's the cricoid cartilage beneath the thyroid. All right, here is a nicer picture. Of course, this is the thyroid cartilage. Here is the laryngeal prominence or the Adam's apple, and then down here is the cricoid cartilage. Cricoid cartilage is right there. Okay, also here are the here is the lamina for the lamina of the thyroid cartilage. One lamina on this side, another lamina on this side, they are meeting in the midline. Okay, so here is another picture. Can you see the thyroid cartilage? It is not forming a complete ring, it is just right there. It is not really forming a complete ring behind, it's not forming a perfect ring. Okay, unlike the cricoid cartilage. The cricoid cartilage is what we have here. Can you come down here? Cricoid cartilage, it forms a complete ring. Okay, it forms a complete ring. And then sitting on top of the cricoid cartilage are two cartilages, the arytenoid cartilages, one on this side and another one on the other side. Okay, so here is the here are the arytenoid cartilages. So just note larynx, thyroid cartilage, the thyroid prominence, very important point, otherwise with the Adam's apple, and then the cricoid cartilage, which actually does form a complete ring. So but thyroid doesn't form, thyroid cartilage doesn't form a complete ring. Alright, coming down to our next model, of course, this structure is the heart, okay? And on the heart, you can be asked to identify the various chambers. Of course, right here is the right ventricle, atrium. Down here is the right ventricle. We have the left ventricle and then the left atrium right here. So you can be asked to identify these various structures during steeplechase. And then don't forget the valves. Right here we have a tricuspid valve and then we have the bicuspid valve right there. Okay, tricuspid made up of three valves, while the one right here is made up of two valves. Okay, you also want to draw your attention to some structures within the heart. Okay, understand that this thickened muscle right here, let me get a better pen. Okay, this thickened muscle, the one I'm labeling green, that is the interventricular septum. Okay, so the interventricular septum is that thickened muscle separating the two ventricles. Okay, and then right here too are the papillary muscles. Are you seeing those projections right there? Those are the papillary muscles, and the papillary muscles are known to attach to these important tendons. These tendons right there, these minor tendons or fiber-like structure, those are the caudal tendinae of the papillary muscles. Okay, so papillary muscles, the muscles themselves, and then they're giving rise to these caudal tendinae, and the caudal tendinae are inserting on the various valves. All right, so here is a better picture of the interventricular septum, the papillary muscles, and of course the caudal tendinae. Okay, straightway to our next model, the lungs. All right, so you have to be able to identify the two lungs. The left lung has just one oblique fissure right there, but for the right lung there are three fissures, the oblique, the horizontal, right? So note that about the lungs. And then I want to draw your attention to the ileum of the lung, where structures are entering and leaving the lung. You have to understand the arrangement around this region. Okay, so for the right lung, for superior to inferior, that is from up to down, we come across the bronchus first, then the pulmonary artery, followed by the hypaterial bronchus. Sorry, the epiterial bronchus is the first here, then the hypaterial bronchus, and then the inferior pulmonary vein. Okay, and of course, too, for the left, the artery is the first, followed by the bronchus, and then the inferior pulmonary vein. I think I have a picture showing all this. So right here, what lung is this? If I'm to ask you, can you take a look at the fissures? Of course, this is the right lung. It has three fissures. Let's take a look at the arrangement. The first hole right here, this hole is the epithelial bronchus, of course. And then the next is the pulmonary arteries right there. And here is the wall, okay, the entrance of it. And then the next is the arterial bronchus, okay. The arterial bronchus is the next to be inferior. And then lastly, we have the pulmonary veins, okay. The pulmonary veins are right there. Here is another pulmonary, and they are the most inferior. So don't forget, from epithelial bronchus, the next is pulmonary artery, then down we have the hypothelial bronchus, and then lastly, the pulmonary veins. Okay, so take note of the first and the last, the bronchus, which is the first, epithelial bronchus, and then the pulmonary vein, which is the last. Okay, so they are very, very common points for steeplechase questions. Okay. Okay, so here is the left lung. Of course, it has just one fissure, the oblique fissure. So let's identify the structures in the ilion now. We have the pulmonary artery, which is the first, and then we have the bronchus, which is the next. The bronchus is the next, and then lastly, we have the pulmonary veins. Just understand that pulmonary vein is always the last in each case. Okay, there you have it. And also on the left lung, there are some important structures to want to draw your attention to. The lingula is one very important point that can be pinned in the steeplechase. Okay, the lingula is that projection, that tongue-like projection from the left lung. And then there is also the cardiac notch. The cardiac notch is a depression into the medial surface of the left lung. All right, so that's that about that. Here is another picture of it, of the various structures around the hilum of the lungs. All right, that's the end of this lecture. Thank you very much for tuning into my channel. If you find the video helpful, do wait to hit the like button and also subscribe. Okay, when you subscribe, you have access to my numerous videos designed just to help your nail success. Thank you.